I worked with a group of my students together this year. We had 12 students. They self-selected. We were paired together because as a new advisor, I was like, hey guys, I love video gaming. So I got 12 adolescent boys who love video gaming, and they are my advisory, and I will be working with them for the next, all last year, and then for the next 3 years. So they opted into this group because they're interested in possibly learning programming, and they're interested in video games. They're also a mixed ability group, so I have students who are several grade levels behind, I have students who are grade levels ahead, I have students with and without disabilities, and of course with various strengths, various personalities, all of those things.
We're a game company, and our focus is turning players into creators. And so we've created this game, open platformer called Beta. And Beta's special ability, it's your standard kind of like Super Meat Boy or Mario style game. But it also has a component where the main mechanic essentially is that players have access to an in-game console. And they can, it's similar to the Python interpreter where they can essentially type commands in and inspect objects, add objects to the game, create multitudes of objects, create conditionals, and trigger events to create complex gameplay. In looking at the spectrum of sort of like game-based learning and the scratches of the world, we're looking at being sort of like the step after that where they actually start writing some syntax-based code, but they're not in a full environment yet where they're taking on so many complexities. And it's really created to just kind of like create flow and create a positive association with their first potential coding experience. So we use Beta in the game, and each player over time was asked to
At Bronx Compass, every single ninth grader is required to take a computer science class. The purpose of this class is to build interest so that the students opt into computer science classes throughout the rest of their high school career. We use a very high interest game design theme. I focus on the development cycle, and next year, this past year was the first year we offered it, and it was all educational languages, so Scratch, Touch Develop. And this coming year, I'm throwing that out, and we'll be introducing Python.
So this year, in using Beta for game development, we essentially worked on the game development cycle. So we had them do some discovery and playing with the game, figuring out different objects and mechanics that they could use. Then they went into paper prototyping, and actually here each student used graph paper. They mapped out, the game's built on a grid, so it's a Cartesian coordinate system. So they get to relate to some high level math concepts and play with the physics engine. Essentially they designed their games, storyboarded them, and then they go into the process of actually coding out the games. And I think we went through two cycles. So we had them build something very simple in the beginning just so they can kind of get that first game out. It's mostly terrible, some don't, just fumbling around, and then we say, hey, look, in about a month or two, you're gonna present your games to the 10th graders, so there's a little bit of social anxiety, but essentially they had something to build towards where something that they've coded and created will be presented to their peers for play testing and review. And so they learn, those processes, they go through a couple of cycles and are able to collaborate and work with each other in a very sort of like startup-y sort of environment. And so these are some pictures of the arcade events. So these are students getting feedback from players on their games. And it was a really wonderful day. There was a lot of anxiety at the beginning. I'm not done, it's not perfect. And you just kind of call, hey, look, this is it. You're testing, you're actually getting feedback from a user. you're going to see that a lot of the assumptions you make about what your player is going to do probably going to be wrong, and you have to become okay with that and learn from that. And it was really great.
Okay, so from this collaboration, we both took away, I mean, I took away a lot as an educator, that when I taught my core class on my own, I didn't get working with Errol as a programmer on this project. I took away a lot that I can take back to that core class that I teach in computer science. One is theory versus practice. As an educator, I am learning computer science for the first time, trying to stay a few steps ahead of my students. That's usually the case in public education, unfortunately, because I don't know how many of you are ready to leave your tech company to go to a public school, but that teacher knows how to troubleshoot Word. That teacher likes to play video games. She can teach computer science. So I'm learning as I go. One thing I noticed, I was trying to mirror the professional world, and I had read about the development cycle. And my husband comes home and he talks about Avid and going through this. So I kind of had a concept, but to know that, to hear stories from work, to read about it in a textbook, I had no idea what that looked like or how to implement it. And that's something that I saw Errol do with the kids, these small development cycles that repeated and repeated. With beta, the students explored. They played beta and started building right away. They didn't realize that they were learning concepts till afterwards. So as opposed to in my class where I'm trying to teach the concept and then say, go do it. The other thing was motivation. I had students who refused to do any work in any classes the whole year, and they learned beta and they learned the language that they needed to build out a game. So the motivation was very high.
For me, it was interesting trying to learning really about the mental models that exist in different students and players' minds, depending on what tools they may have been exposed to. At this age, a lot of them have played with Scratch. A lot of them have used Lego robotics or have no idea. And so it was interesting to see sort of that there's what the on-ramp needs to look like to get them to start thinking, to motivate them to actually get into, deep enough into a language or a project where they'll actually kind of stick to it and get that experience that I think we as developers really enjoy that allows us to keep coding. And also just how that works and what the teacher really needs in that, right? In the school, there are a lot of forces at play as far as what teachers need to be able to accomplish and show, and what students need to show, what administration needs to show. And so there are many forces at play, and I think it was interesting to see that environment firsthand. Cooperative learning is exactly what it sounds like. In the very beginning, there were two or three students that just, they devoured every single thing that we threw at them and went beyond. And they were very quick to begin to answer questions of other students. And then there were also students that were just really hesitant to jump in. And what I found was really interesting to do was actually to combine those two so that when somebody was lagging asked a question, you specifically pair them up with somebody who was really into it. And it seemed like enthusiasm was contagious. But also they became dependent on each other to solve the problems that they were facing. And I think that also showed that the sage on the stage, which is what we're doing right now to some extent, was not exactly the most effective way of trying to encourage somebody to get into this field. It was really about the act of doing that propelled things forward. And even though I said about this talk, we're going to do a little mini hackathon in a few. So get ready to get your hands dirty, and I don't want to see anybody leaving. And then lastly, soft structured classes. We worked with a number of schools this year, and there were some classrooms that were very hard and structured, very kind of regimented and formal, I guess you could say. And then on the other side of the spectrum, there was no visible structure. It was kind of just reaching, for gas. And in med school, there was a sort of healthy balance of both in that there was structure, there was expectation, but you know, as you saw from the pictures, they get their laptop and they can kind of like sit in the corner with, you know, or feel comfortable to maneuver. And it was really about exploration, explorative learning, which I think was really powerful. And as a developer, you know, my best moments come when I'm working with people on something in a space where, you know, we're comfortable and there's that sort of war room or peace room, whatever you want to call it, you know, where you're just, you know, really building. I think that over time we're able to build that, and that was really beautiful. I'd love to see that more across the world.
So one thing we want to talk about is what problems do educators have, what problems do developers have, and in a few minutes we're going to pose a challenge question to you based on these problems. So first I'll share, as a computer science educator, my needs as an educator. So one is that it's really important to me to open the door to computer science for every student. They come in ninth grade, they might think, oh, that's for nerds, that's for the smart kids, whatever that means. They're not necessarily opting into this class, and I think it's really important that they all have a good experience with it, that they're all exposed to it and realize that it's something they can do if they like it. So one of the really important things in my class is that they're able to experience successes right away that are tangible. And that's something with the learning curve of programming that you don't always get. They don't come in necessarily with the perseverance to learn syntax and write out a mini program that doesn't do much right away. They don't come in ready for that. The other thing as a teacher I need to learn the content. I need training. I'm not getting any of that from the education world. The other thing is real world connections. For high school students, it is so important that they see people who have done this, that they see what that path was for people, how they can go on that path, how this applies to their lives now and in the future.
And for developers thinking about, you know, entering the space or just, you know, servicing, I think being aware of pedagogy, how there are so many different methods and philosophies on how people learn and how to design spaces that allow people to learn better. And I think in having interacted with educators heavily over the last year, there were some things that I felt I was really able to internalize that I think could help my team become better developers. Meaningful and accessible feedback from tools. So there's nothing worse than, I mean, I don't know how many of you remember when you saw your first error and you were like, what is this saying? Oh my God. You know, and that feeling, I think is really foreign to a lot of beginners. And so I think, you know, in creating tools that are on ramps, it would be really interesting to see errors that were almost like human, you know, like to the extent that they were almost encouraging.
We talked about playful feedback.
Just an idea. And then context is not always a formal CS environment. I think that learning STEM has become steamed. So, you know, there's arts and design now being integrated in it. And I think that there's a bigger context now for an entryway into CS that I think should be considered in how we design tools to be integrated. And that collaborative space, I think we're going to see a lot of changes in the DOE and in schools and how and whom is put together to create. So having that context and seeing the effect of the environment on learning STEM was really powerful and something I think developers would be, it'd be advantageous for them to explore. So, mini hackathon time.
So one thing I've already met with. Pose this, and we'll do questions.
We can do questions first, so okay. That they can have some clarification, and then you guys will kind of like join little groups and a little bit of brainstorming to come up with some ideas.
Excellent.
Are you finding students that are coming in that know a lot more than you would expect them to know? I mean, when I was in high school, I probably didn't hardly imagine that these kids have some background in it, and then some don't.
I've only had a handful of students come in, and when they do come in and they're already interested, a lot of times, so they're incoming ninth graders, they'll have worked through maybe one track of Code Academy. There's a lot of online tools, but the level is still, it's still pretty low. It's nothing beyond the scope of the beginning class, yeah.
Do you see a future where these kids won't go to college? Code in high school, and in ninth grade, 10th grade, I mean, in 2-3 years, they can, especially with the Python, and you're going to start teaching them. I could imagine foreseeing a future where, why would I go to a 4-year school, spend a lot of money, if yeah. I could create content?
Well, that's one of the goals of our school. So we're going to be a CTE school, which means that they will get a career certificate. However, I actually was talking to a tech recruiter at a meetup last week, and he was saying that still, if you have the 4-year degree, you're still coming in at a much higher pay rate. So it's not 100% necessary. I feel like I want to leave every door open for my students that they want to pursue. So if they want to go into work right after high school, I want them to have all the programming tools they can. They want to go to college, I want them to have all the tools they can to get accepted whenever they want. My goal is like every door open.
And having worked in a number of schools this year, I definitely saw that in the more affluent schools, there was a significantly higher number of students that were relatively well trained in computer science at a 10th or 11th grade level. And then, you know, I was at a coffee shop in my neighborhood, and you know, saw this kid. I mean, he could have been more than 12, getting like Java training for a couple hours on a Saturday. So there's a major investment in that being made at certain levels. But I think the key word in this is accessibility. In lack of people who in your neighborhood who may know how to code, or teachers who have even an interest in caring. Meg is a unique case in that she's like, hey, I'm just going to do this, and I'm going to learn it and go with it. And we have found that there are teachers that aren't taking that up, but they still need a lot of context for how to pull that out. So
also role models within the community that have gone into programming. That's one thing that in my school it's harder to find that I'm always looking for.
Question. You mentioned that, like, in building the video games, they're learning something about physics, something about math. Is that a goal wrapped in this to like teach them some fundamentals about math and physics, or is it more just kind of like, hey, you're working towards this goal of building a video game? I mean, it sounds like the context of the school is more project-based and you're not like thinking about standardized tests, but like, I'm just curious whether that sort of factors into that, if you're like trying to teach them this, like, these fundamental math concepts and physics concepts along the way.
So when we do workshops and classes, when those topics come up, we discuss them, and create an opportunity to bridge these concepts that they may often just say, okay, so I put a dot on this cross thing, when do I ever need or use that, and I think that we do create those bridges, and the physics engine has a lot of properties in terms of, friction, velocity, mass, and they, when they can play with gravity and just start moving things around, you get some really interesting experiments. I had this one kid who, creates masses of things and it just like shoots the character just to see the explosions that occur.
Gross.
And that's something that we want them to play with. What happens when you release an 8-year-old onto a physics engine? You get some amazing stuff, right? So that's sort of what we like to play. But as far as like our curriculum, we want them to play with that, but it's not, for me at least, and my goal, if the teacher says, hey, I really want to map this to it, and we work with them to do that, but it's not like the main focus. So.
I like that it reinforces their open classes.
Mm-hmm.
but I feel like it's too overwhelming to focus on learning programming concepts and physics and math.
So it's less about, like, there's other places where they'd be learning the math and the physics, but it does maybe hopefully give them a bridge or something.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Cool. I'm curious, Meg, why you mentioned how you're moving away from the sort of educated languages and going to Python. I'm a fan of that. I'm happy. But I'm just curious why that decision was made.
So we use Scratch, which is a visual block-based educational language developed by MIT to teach programming concepts. I've seen it work really well in the middle schools that are using it in the software engineering pilot that we're part of. But at the high school level, the students are often, it kind of has a dismotivating effect because the students see it and they think, oh, this is for little kids. Also, they can pick it up pretty quickly, like a game, because it's block-based. And I almost find that because the challenge isn't there, it's a little bit disincentivizing because they want something that's challenging. You can do really challenging things in Scratch, but because of that impression of, oh, that's for kids, it's harder to get them to stick with it and do those challenging things. So I do plan to use it as an introduction, but I'm not going to stay on it very long just for that reason.
You had a question?
Well, actually, mine was the same as I got one for each of you, that's okay. Meg, you talked earlier on how it's kind of like a semi-structured environment, and I'm wondering, are you just teaching programming, or are you teaching the other facets of computer science too, like algorithms, data structures? And then, Errol, you mentioned that you went from these other environments were very visual to having kind of an interpreter like experience and data. And can you tell us more about the thinking behind that and why visual?
Sure. The goal is to incorporate those things eventually into the curriculum. Since I'm learning myself, it's coming together piecemeal and starting where I'm strongest and where I'm learning, and then hopefully I'm building my education, I'm able to expand that to be more holistic.
Like Meg mentioned, you know, at the top of Scratch, I feel like we still have block-based programming. And one thing that I find interesting when we do workshops is like how little keyboarding kids are doing these days. Like everything is touch, right? So it's actually like this really interesting interaction when you start having them have to type out commands and kind of like input and output. And so we just, you know, I really enjoyed the interpreter, and I really enjoyed sort of like seeing, it's just an environment where I feel like I'm playing with code, but once I hit that enter button, something happens, and I know whether it succeeded or not. And and thinking about instant feedback for the instant generation, how do you create an experience where they can take really small steps, but actually create a lot of complexity. And so that was the vision going there, as opposed to like creating an editor and then letting them write stuff and then having to compile it. The game is played at the same time in which it is coded. Those two experiences are not separated. And so in order to do that without having to completely change the user interface mode completely, we wanted to make something that could overlay and that could be really quick. So, and in that we use tabbing, autocomplete, you know, there's going back in history. So there's like certain keyboarding things that would make them comfortable as they transition into the Python interpreter. And the programming language that we wrote is called CodePop. It's still very much in development, but there's a lot that you can do with it. And over time, we're working to just model it more cleanly after Python, so that the transition in is absolutely seamless, and then they have a bigger world to explore once they arrive there. All right, 11:26.
Yeah.
You guys tried to ask a lot of questions. Join your team at your tables.
What we'd like you to do is get in a group of maybe three, two to three people, whoever's around you, get together. If one person has a computer and can go to the basic address, it's just an open Google Doc. And we're just going to do a brainstorm for the next few minutes. We will be taking the results of the brainstorm and using them as a starting point for an education hackathon that NYC Python has agreed to host and let us run in the fall. So this is the start. What we would like to do is start a conversation with you today. We feel like this is a big issue that, and the conversation is just starting both in the education and programming world. And so we want to invite you to be a part of that. Our question for you to brainstorm today is how can we make computer programming accessible, engaging, and useful to all students? And we're thinking primarily on the high school level.
And think big, think wacky, think outside the box, and also try to return yourself to your 13 or 14-year-old self when, you know, where you were and what interested you and what may have created the glue. How did you get into it? You know, was it an enjoyable experience? And if it was, awesome. How do you work on that? And if it wasn't, how do you, you know, what allowed you to persevere? So really reflect and just go at it. Enjoy.